Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You may know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and this series is prepared for the months of January, February, and March of 2016. It's a great series entitled Rebellion and Redemption, and it's a focus on what we call the Great Controversy theme. It's a theme about all the accusations that Satan has made, all the attempts he's made to try to destroy trust in God, and how God has responded. But we're now only in lesson two, and that, of course, takes us back to the crisis in Eden. This lesson is for January 9 of 2016. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, we turn now once again to the Holy Scriptures to think about the momentous things that happened back there in the Garden of Eden. What a glorious and wonderful place, and how sad it was that our first parents blew it and were deceived by the devil. Help us not to make those same mistakes in our day, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm. So what happened in the Garden of Eden? What did God create? And what happened to God's beautiful garden? Those are the questions we're going to want to really talk about. Genesis 1:31, let's just look at that for a second. Hope you have your Bible handy. It may be a little different translation than mine. Mine's the Good News Bible. Genesis 1:31, God looked at everything he had made and he was very pleased. Everything passed, evening passed and morning came. That was the sixth day. So it's a pretty awesome start. Everything was very good. He was very pleased. So how do we explain the chaos, the insecurity, the violence, the war, the pollution, the oppression, the exploitation that we see in our world today? Was God responsible for that?
Well, that's God is order and not chaos. And he is peace, and when you separate yourself from that, then you end up in chaos and lack of peace.
Yeah. Well, Genesis 1 and 2, as you know, I'm sure out there, just as we do here, is a story of how that all got started. What happened, the beginning, really, of our world's history. And the role we're going to see in Genesis 3, the role of a certain serpent or snake. And what does that mean for our understanding of the Great Controversy? For Bible-believing Christians, Genesis 1 tells of the seven 24-hour evening and morning days in which God created our world. And what did he create on day seven?
Sabbath.
The Sabbath. A rest, a time for rest. After each of those days, God pronounced his work good. While it is possible, as many believe, that Earth was here long before creation week, looking something like maybe the moon or Mars or something like that, when God came here and decided to pick this as a place where he's going to make a new world, what did he produce? The most beautiful garden that you can possibly imagine. We call it the Garden of Eden.
Now, God said that it was very good. Mm-hmm. Would you agree with him?
Absolutely.
How do you know? You've never seen it.
Well, I agree with him because of the descriptions that are written about it.
I think it's
the word is
Elohim said it was very good. Mm-hmm. And Elohim has a lot of other ways to say it. All through Genesis 1 is Elohim. You get to Genesis 2, verse 4, and it says, and this is a record of God's, of Yahweh Elohim's creation. So I think it was his family was agreeing. Everything was hunky-dory down here.
Well, that's interesting.
After creating the Garden of Eden step by step, God announced blessings in three specific areas. In Genesis 1:22, he blessed the birds and the sea creatures, and he said, multiply and fill the earth. And then the next day when he created animals and humans, he said the same thing. So that was the first big blessing.
Now, do you think that they filled the earth then?
No, but he said, he told them that was your ultimate goal, to populate the earth.
So there could have been just a few animals on that day.
Yeah, you mean back at the beginning?
Yeah, on that day that they were created.
Yeah.
There might have been just a few.
Well, okay, that's maybe one, a pair of each of the prime kinds of separate kinds of animals. Remember that?
Which after that, they could multiply and fill
the earth. We might say that those original kinds were genuses or something like that. And remember genuses and then their species beyond that. But
one reason that would support that is because he said the same thing to Adam and Eve. Mm-hmm. And they didn't multiply this on the sixth day and fill the earth.
So it may well have been very similar to the numbers that were present in the ark at the time of the flood that came off the ark.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, the second great blessing was when humankind, was given dominion over all the other living things. They were supposed to be caring for them, responsible for them, protecting them. That was supposed to be our relationship to the animals. And then finally in Genesis 2:3, the third great blessing, the seventh-day Sabbath. It was supposed to be a time when not only all of us would rest, but the whole world would rest. Oh, in what ways are humans different than animals?
The more we find out about animals, the more we find there are
many ways in which they're
like us.
I'm not arguing about that. I want to know what ways are we different.
Cognitive function.
The cognitive functions.
Frontal lobes.
The ability to speak and to think. And along with that comes freedom, free choice. Animals do not have that. That presumably is what God was talking about when he said we would be made in the image of God. So it's interesting to notice that as God is producing step by step the creation process, he's going through the creation process, he set forth very clearly defined boundaries. And it seems almost like the boundaries were a major part of the creation. There was light versus darkness. There was the waters above and the waters beneath. There was land and sea. There was night and day. There were men and women. He also produced two very important trees, and of course we know. Which trees were they?
Tree of life.
The tree of life.
The tree of knowledge.
And the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
Let me ask this before we get too far into that. You said that animals don't have the free to choose. You know, I've known some pretty mean cats.
Yes?
You know, they're just mean. Uh-huh. And other cats are very loving. Mm-hmm.
It's probably a part of their training.
Well, I can see how that's a good answer, but I'm not convinced.
That's all there is to it, huh?
You know, there are animals that that are very nurturing. We have pictures of dogs who have adopted kittens or squirrels, you know, and nurtured them. So I don't know where that falls into the free choice category or something, but it sure seems like there's got to be something.
When talking about animals and doing crazy things and fighting and that kind of stuff, I will never forget the day I was living in Africa in those days, and two or three of us were down at the neighbor's place, and out in behind his house he had a small wild animal park, basically what it was, with some ostriches, and he had a cheetah and he had some other things there. And in that area there was this gargantuan tree. They had some huge trees in that part of Africa. And we were just standing there talking, and all of a sudden we heard this terrible racket. And there are birds in Africa called barbets. And these two barbets had gotten each hold of the other's beak like this. They were each holding on to the other's beak. And they lost their footing in the tree, way up there in the tree. And here came these two barbets flopping down to the ground, both of them scaring like this. But they would not let go of the other's beak until they hit the ground. And they finally, after they hit the ground, they, you know, sort of let go, and but I mean,
probably knocked out.
What about we had a hawk who set up a nest near my home, and I got near the nest, mm-hmm. And the hawk warned me away. Mm-hmm. And then later on, when I walked away and paid it, you know, he came after, she came after me again, and she scraped me on the back of my head with, there were three little claw marks, which it's obvious to me that it was a warning. I won't go into the explanation
of
why.
She didn't try to pick you up and carry you off?
No, no, but she could have.
Yeah.
So, you know, she could have inflicted very serious harm, but it was obvious to me that she chose not to do that, just to let me know I shouldn't be there. So, no, it seems to me like animals have some kind of a moral code or something.
Well, yeah, we could discuss that. In Genesis 1, right through, in a number of places, God seems to want us to understand that there are clearly defined boundaries. He wants them to understand what our relationships are supposed to be to others and to the universe. God gave very specific instructions to Adam and Eve. They were to eat daily of the tree of life, but they were never to eat the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And maybe we should just read those verses. Those are very important verses. Genesis 2, 15 to 17. Then the Lord God placed the man in the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and guard it. He said to him, "You may eat the fruit of any tree in the garden except the tree that gives knowledge of what is good and what is bad. You must not eat the fruit of that tree. If you do, you will die the same day." That's a pretty serious threat, wouldn't you say? Or was it a warning? Threat or warning?
Warning.
Adam and Eve understood very clearly that they were not supposed to eat of that fruit. So what do you think was unusual about that tree? Was the fruit poisonous? Why were they not even supposed to go near it? Well, let me.
And why did he put that in the center?
Yeah. And he put it in the center of the garden, right next to, right close to the tree of life. So they had to go close enough to see it every day, maybe multiple times in a day.
That's where this serpent was and where Lucifer could communicate to the new creatures, the new human beings.
Do you think it was the fruit that was the problem, or was it the serpent with the fruit?
Well, let me read you this and see what you think. This is Patriarchs and Prophets, page 53, paragraph 2. The tree of knowledge had been made a test of their obedience and their love to God. So in one respect, it's a test. The Lord had seen fit to lay upon them but one prohibition as to the use of all that was in the garden. But if they should disregard his will in this particular, they would incur the guilt of transgression. Satan was not to follow them with continual temptations. He could have access to them only at the forbidden tree. That's a really important point that a lot of people don't catch. Should they attempt to investigate its nature, they would be exposed to his wiles. They were admonished to give careful heed to the warning which God had sent them and to be content with the instructions which he had seen fit to impart. Patriarchs and Prophets 53, paragraph 3. How long would the tree have lasted?
How long would Satan have been permitted to?
Well, that's a good question. We don't really know. What we do know is Ellen White says there were other places, other worlds, where the tree was put temporarily and then it was taken away because they rejected it. How long that takes, I don't know. Those other worlds don't have the ability to procreate. So we keep producing more and more people, all of whom need to make their choices. So... yes.
If one keeps making the same decision over and over, that decision becomes more and more a part of you, and to accept Satan's lies may no longer be a live option to those people. Yeah. So he says, okay, I'll go.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Ellen White does go on to say, and I wish we had time to look at all these passages, not only God, but the angels came down to the garden and warned Adam and Eve repeatedly about that tree. So it's not like He just mentioned it briefly, and they were curious. They had adequate warning.
You think, in addition to those warnings and other communications and talks that God had with Adam and Eve in the garden, do you think he went over this, the information that we had in lesson one of last week in our this business of this war in heaven? And
yes,
he made it.
Yes.
They were aware of.
I don't know how much, but Ellen White once again says, yes, they were told about the war in heaven.
Do we have any clue on what heaven is, or the unfallen angels are thinking in the midst of this great controversy? God's taking the time to create a whole new planet and calling it good, and he seems so relaxed in the process. He even takes a whole day to rest.
Yeah, we have some clues. Maybe I should just, let's look at. Here's my best clue. Give me just a second, we'll go there. It's found in Job 38 and verse 7. In the dawn of that day, that would be the beginning of that day, the stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy. So this is, and if you read the context, it's talking about creation. So the entire universe was excited about what God did. Okay? Shouted for joy. Imagine all of heaven shouting for joy. Well, are there things which God tells us about that we need to be warned about in our day? Well, he tells us to avoid sin, disobedience, stealing, gambling, adultery, jealousy, envy, covetousness, a lot of forms of worldly entertainment. I mean,
remember the Sabbath.
Remember, but that's not a warning against something. Think how much better our lives can be and will be if we avoid those things. Well, let's look at the whole scenario here. We know, we read about what God said to Adam and Eve. Now let's look at the other side. It's fair to look at both sides, right? Genesis 3. Now the snake was the most cunning animal that the Lord God had made. Now what do you suppose that means?
Was created
smart.
He was smart.
But now
snake smart today.
Well, now wait a minute here. We mentioned the difference between humans and animals as cognition. So how can this snake be cunning of all the others? Well, isn't that cognition?
Hold on.
There goes your cognition business.
That was before the fall.
So the snake asked the woman, did God really tell you not to eat from any tree in the garden?
I haven't run into too many snakes that would speak to me other than hissing.
If you saw one speaking, it would get your attention, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Yes, it really would.
Wow.
Especially if you know this story.
this is a very special snake, right? How does she respond? We may eat the fruit of any tree in the garden, the woman answered, except the tree in the middle of it. And she's standing there and she's looking at it, right? She's talking to a snake in that tree. God told us not to eat the fruit of that tree or even touch it. If we do, we will die.
Didn't he tell them not to go near the tree?
Well, they first
it's okay
that,
to go no, near
that,
the tree,
that
just
been
don't
good
eat
advice.
The fruit?
Don't go even near it.
But to me, that raises a question. Did the other snakes talk? She didn't seem too surprised by it. Which, in my way of thinking, if he was the only one, that should have woken her up.
She might have had a pet snake, and now this one's talking. She might have had one that flew around.
Yeah.
We don't, you know.
We're also very young.
Because the condemnation later was you're going to crawl on your belly and eat dirt.
Yeah. Well, the snake replied, that's not true, you will not die. So what's he saying right up front?
God's a liar.
God said that because he knows that when you eat it, you will be like God and know what is good and what is bad.
That's true. And you put the two together, you have deception, truth and error.
The woman saw how beautiful the tree was and how good its fruit would be to eat. Apparently it just looked good. And she thought how wonderful it would be to become wise. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband, and he also ate it. As soon as they had eaten it, they were given understanding, and realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and covered themselves. Myra, I'm sorry, unfortunately, you're the only female here today. Have you ever tried to sew fig leaves together? I can't imagine. I mean, that just...
They might have had different characteristics than current fig leaves.
Maybe.
Now, doesn't... they were tougher in those early days.
I see. Maybe bigger, too.
Doesn't Ellen White almost also say that Adam and Eve were... They were not to leave one another's side?
Yes.
And so on, and
he wandered away, and then neither she nor Adam did anything about it.
So, where I'm going with this, if they were told not to separate, and Eve got over there, and Adam wasn't keeping an eye out for, and she wasn't paying any attention to where he was, weren't they already disobeying, and didn't they sin before they ever got to the tree?
Well, in a sense. Yeah.
What do you mean?
What went on
sense?
In their mind?
How can you sin in a sense?
Well, that's called temptation.
Gordon has looked like he's got something he wants to say.
Well, they weren't doing the best thing. Is that a sin?
Oh my
goodness! Or is sin transferring your trust from God to the devil?
Oh, we're really rationalizing.
I got another question though. As far as Adam and Eve leaving, why did God leave?
Leave what?
He left. Remember he came during the cool of the day?
Mm-hmm.
Why did he leave?
Give him freedom to act and
he has the whole universe to take
life.
Care of.
You mean he's got to be somewhere to do that?
Well, he didn't.
As Jim says, he had to give them freedom to choose. That. You know, if God's there all the time, no, don't do that, don't do that.
Wait a minute. Isn't that part of the issue right now? Is God with us now?
Well, Jesus says, I got to go, and if I go, that because if you have the authority figure, all or even the smartest guru around all the time, you'd stop thinking.
No.
Of course.
Well, there's something even more cosmic here in that God is omnipresent, so how could he come and go? Why wasn't he always in the garden?
He was.
Well, that's...
So...
But the question here is not whether God's there. He's there. The question is whether they perceived his presence.
That's right.
That's what the issue.
Well, it sounds in the Bible like he came back in the cool of the day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what's the difference?
What's the difference? Accused them of being
what
unfair?
I just said, they perceived his presence. He allowed himself to be seen. He doesn't allow us to see him. He's here, but he doesn't allow
us
to see
him. That was Yahweh,
yeah.
The physical manifestation of the one infinite God was Yahweh. And he presented himself, but like he did to Abraham and Moses and so on and so forth. But it comes and goes.
He still left. He left them.
The physical, they weren't able to perceive him.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
but
his immediate
manifestation of his presence was gone. So whether he was there or not there,
isn't that what happens when sin happens? Is when God leaves?
God doesn't leave anybody.
He can't leave. It's impossible.
He's gone. He's not there.
In the story.
No, I think there's something symbolic here that's really important. Okay, well then, think about it. Well, just what I'm saying. He's gone. They sin.
That's the freedom that they have to have.
Absolutely. This is beyond freedom here. Yeah. What I'm talking about. When God is gone, you're separated from God. That's when sin happens.
When you're separated from God, you're dead. Yes.
Then
absolutely, you're dead. Very clear.
Satan is still alive?
God's sustaining him.
Because God's sustaining him. He's not separate from God.
But he warns.
He did walk away from his presence. Ellen White says
that's what I said. They didn't
see. And so now God, or the Son of God, is gone when all this happens. And then he comes back into the garden.
They recognize his presence, yes.
I think there's something symbolic here, and I think we need to think about it.
Okay, we've got to talk about a lot of other things. What do we know about this snake? Is there a difference between a snake and a serpent? Probably not. There's some very interesting stories told in Numbers 21, Deuteronomy 8, that you remember the time when the children of Israel were out there, and this is the third time that they've complained about the food. And what happens? Yeah, let me see here. They complained, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to die in this desert where there is no food or water? We can't stand any more of this miserable food." They're talking about angels' food. "Then the Lord sent poisonous snakes among the people, and many Israelites were bitten and died." And a lot of people read that and say, "Wow, God is really mean."
From where are you reading?
I'm reading Numbers 21, and that was verse 6. "The people came to Moses and said, 'We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Now pray to the Lord to take these snakes away.' So Moses prayed to the people, prayed for the people. Then the Lord told Moses to make a metal snake and put it on a pole so that anyone who was bitten could look at it and be healed. So Moses made a bronze snake and put it on a pole. Anyone who had been bitten would look at the bronze snake and be healed." Now,
it's a funny story.
It's a funny story. What you need, in order to understand the story, you have to go over to Deuteronomy 8, verse 15, where Moses goes back and he talks about this story. I wish he had said it back there in Numbers. But in 8:15 we read, "He led you through that vast and terrifying desert where there were poisonous snakes and scorpions. In that day, in waterless land, he made water flow out of solid rock for you." In other words, why was it that they hadn't been bitten by the snakes sooner? God was protecting them. That's why they hadn't been bitten all along. See? So God just says, "Okay, if you don't like my food, if you don't like me around, let me just back off a little bit." Gary, you want to know what happens when God backs off a little bit? They got bitten. So Moses makes this solid snake, this bronze snake, and they start looking at it and they're healed. They ended up worshiping that snake for the next 700 years. Till finally, King Hezekiah in 2 Kings 18:4 finally destroys the bronze snake.
Why did he pick a snake in the first place?
Yeah, seems a little.
That's the puzzle.
Yeah, because they're symbols of evil.
But why would they look at the snake to be saved?
Why didn't he tell him to look at the cloudy pillar or the cloud of fire?
If you looked at this,
well, I'll let you ask him that question.
Does a snake give salvation, that they look at him?
Absolutely not.
Well, then why did
it's
they?
It's a piece of metal.
No, but it was in the shape of a snake.
Yeah, it's still a piece of metal.
You know, if it was in the shape of a pear, it would be different. But because it's got a snake in there, and our understanding of the snake, that's what kind of confuses everything.
Okay. I want to go on because we've got a lot of other things to talk about. We read the passages in Genesis 3, and unfortunately, most of us don't know anything about Hebrew. But in the original Hebrew, the question that Satan asks, well, and I would say Satan to the snake, asks Eve is, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" So he's really saying God hasn't given you permission to eat from any tree in this whole garden. That was the question.
Well, I think Satan was being very crafty because he's setting it up so that Eve can correct him. We can eat anything except for this.
He was engaging her, and so she gets into the conversation. And mm-hmm. So what do we know about this?
Appealing to her cognition.
Yes. What do we know about this snake? Well, over in Revelation 12, verse 9, what does it say about this ancient serpent? He's also called the devil or Satan.
The deceiver.
The deceiver of the whole world. In these words, devil, comes from a Greek word, diabolos. And the word Satan comes from a Hebrew word, shatan. So those are words, we get one from Greek and the other from Hebrew. The word diabolos might even suggest a kind of mudslinger, someone who wants to smear someone else's person or reputation. So when the serpent asked Eve that question, what was he implying? Was he just asking a casual question?
He was trying to engage her.
And he was implying a lot of stuff. He's saying, Did God really say that? Now, when you say it like that, what are you implying? Surely God wouldn't say that. You can't just say, oh, no.
Opportunity for rationalization.
Exactly. There are obviously other issues behind the question. Why would someone try to imply that God had said something that God clearly had not said? What was Satan's purpose in this question? And you just answered part of it. He was engaging her in
repartee.
Exactly. So, any other things? What was the purpose of the question? He's trying to smear God's character. He's trying to say, God is actually forbidding you from eating any tree in this whole garden? The question is stated in such a way as to suggest that God forbidden Adam and Eve from eating any tree in the garden. What we see is that the serpent was not making a simple inquiry of Eve. He was implying a lot of terrible things about God. Well, we already looked at this, but let's look at it again. What did God actually say? He said to him, you may eat the fruit of any tree in the garden. So did God make it very clear? He did, didn't he? Except the tree that gives knowledge of what is good and what is bad. So God has spelled it out very clearly. But did Satan want them to understand clearly this distinction? Not at all. He wanted to make God look as bad as possible. So who was doing the speaking there?
The devil himself.
The devil himself, Satan. And he was trying to suggest that God is really stingy with his blessings. Here's all this beautiful fruit and all the trees, but I don't think God wanted you to eat any of it. Just think about that. In actual fact, God was a very generous God, giving them permission to eat from all but one tree in the garden. Moreover, placing that one tree in the garden gave Adam and Eve a clear choice. One, following God's directions at all times, or two, venture onto dangerous ground by eating of the fruit of that one tree. In other words, that one tree gave them a kind of freedom of choice. Now, we sometimes talk about it as a test of their obedience, but it's really what?
Protection.
Well, we're going to get to that. It gives them a choice. It's a clear choice. Are you going to obey God or are you not going to obey God? So it gives them freedom. That tree gave them freedom. But as we noted in Ellen White's words above, there was perhaps an even more important reason why that tree was placed there. It was to be a protection for them. In what sense was it a protection?
Satan could only confront them at that one site.
And so to avoid him completely and not have any problems with him, all they had to do was just keep a clear boundary from that tree. Stay away from that tree, and we would still be living there.
Is it kind of hard if the tree's in the middle of the garden, though?
Well, and why was it in the middle?
So they couldn't do what you said.
No, they still could have done that.
Oh, could they? Just walk around the edges all the time and stay away from the tree?
Why was the tree put in the middle of the garden?
Give Satan a fair chance, too.
Yeah, so there's no way Satan could claim that he was, you know, I mean, God obviously could have put that tree in the farthest corner, some dark spot where they would never find it. And, of course, Satan would say that's not fair, wouldn't he?
So you are saying that they had to kind of go around the perimeter since it's in the... Okay.
Why was it necessary to give Satan another opportunity to...
Was a mess.
To make his claims. He'd already had an opportunity, and you could see what the results were there. Mm-hmm. Isn't that proof enough what happened there in heaven? Why do we have to come down here?
Well, okay. Why do we conduct experiments and we have control groups and experimental groups?
Beats me.
Come on, you got to do better than that.
We have to be able to reproduce the results.
And hopefully, we have to be able to reproduce the results, and hopefully you're going to reproduce those results in an unbiased fashion. You're going to take a new group of people that hopefully don't know about what you're trying to do, and they don't know, in the case of medicine, for example, they're not sure whether those pills they're taking are really the real pills or the fake pills. you know?
And they can get sick even though they haven't been exposed to the illness.
Yeah.
So you're using this metaphor for what?
We're saying God is allowing Satan to approach these unbiased people to see what's going to happen.
So you already said that they did the same thing in another world and it didn't happen. So how could that be reproducible?
Well, they did in heaven. A third of the angels.
No, I was talking about
the other world.
Right. The other world that the Tree of Life was in, and they didn't fall. Mm-hmm. So how could this be reproducible, since it looks like it was the same conditions, different result?
My perception of the reason for that is that everybody has to have, I guess, a chance to make their choice, but why do you have to have Satan around to make the choice?
Well, Satan didn't need anybody around for him to say.
Right, right. So you don't need Satan in the tree to be
tempted. But here's my question. I want you to think about this for a second. If Satan had been really allowed to go wherever he wanted to, where would he go?
On the shoulder the whole time.
On the shoulder the whole time, or at least to the Tree of Life, right? Wouldn't that be where you'd want to be?
Any factor in the realization that if we understand it correctly, the people on this planet were unique and special. We do not have information that would lead us to conclude that whatever other beings are on, let's say, other planets, that they have the ability to reproduce. We don't know that they don't. But
Ellen White says we are a new and distinct order of beings.
She also says we are a crowning act in creation, and I've wondered if so often we think, well, that's a crowning act here on planet Earth compared to elephants, but that may also be a crowning act in the entire universe, which is pretty scary.
Yeah. Well, God, of course, was hoping that we would never have to know anything. We'd never get to know anything about evil. We're already like God. He created us to be like God. Did we need to know anything about evil? Do we really need to know anything about evil?
Well, would he still have shown the results of sin?
We wouldn't have understood the length that the infinite would go to explain the facts of life. Because he would have never come and demonstrated as he did 2,000 years ago. Wouldn't have been necessary. But our understanding and appreciation for God should be greatly expanded because of the lessons that have been portrayed over the millennia.
Well, and there must be not all the lessons have been learned.
Yeah.
It's kind of an upside to the downside.
Yeah. There's got to be some more lessons that have to be learned of some kind, or we wouldn't still be here.
Yeah, I'd love to talk about that, but we don't have time. I'll do that later. Can you think of other areas in life, even in maybe our own lives, where Satan has tried to deceive by mixing truth with error?
Are you wanting confession time here?
Well, you could use generic terms.
It's a kind of a priest without the separate little room here. That's not confession time, is it?
God gives us grapes, and what do? We turn it into alcohol. God gives us wheat and barley and hops, if you will, and we turn it into beer.
Gives us potatoes, and we turn it into alcohol.
Right, exactly.
You must be talking in generic terms, because that doesn't include me on the raisins and the and the grapes.
Now we've been able to take anything and turn it into alcohol.
Humans, generically.
Well, if everything was complete error, you could figure it out just by looking at it. You've got to have the good mixed into it and hidden, the error hidden in there somewhere.
So, did we become more like God by knowing good and evil?
Well, God knew what it was all about.
Yeah.
And the rest of the intelligent creatures knew of it, but we didn't. In fact, the rest of the intelligent creatures probably didn't understand the whole thing, because we found that 2,000 years ago, at the time of the cross, Colossians 1, 19 and 20, and Ephesians 1, 9 and 10, Jesus going to the cross brought peace to the beings in the heavenly places.
They had a lot to learn.
Yep.
First Peter.
And he could, yeah. Yes. 1 Corinthians 4:9. But none of that could have taken place, but they're expanding in appreciation for the infinite is greatly expanded because of what has transpired.
Well, can you think of some things that God doesn't want us to know anything about? I really wish we didn't know about.
Sin.
Sin, obviously. Many modern destructive habits like smoking and drinking and using illegal drugs and tasting unhealthy types of foods. And of course, back to entertainment, which seems to be the big thing in our world today.
Mostly the consequences of those things, the pain.
Well, we all wish that we could, well, let's not say that. We hope we don't all wish this, but the world seems to wish that they could do all the sins without the consequences.
Now, if he didn't want us to know all this stuff, well then, why are we going through it?
Because we chose it.
Because we chose to do so.
And so we need to if he hadn't have chosen it, that means it would have happened. I mean, it could have happened sometime.
Maybe.
So if...
There goes Gary's inevitability theory again, that he talked about last week.
Well, obviously, God knows why. If you go this way, you're going to die. And if you go this way, you're going to live. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if I know that now, I'm more like God, right? And isn't it good to be more like God?
Yes.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, and that's true. Yeah, in that sense, if you're saying that you have to know that this is the wrong path and this is the right path, at
least.
If
we only knew the right path and there was a wrong path and you didn't know it, is that good?
Sometimes mature adults learn by the mistakes of others instead of making their own mistakes.
But somebody's got to make those mistakes.
Well, Lucifer made those mistakes in heaven.
Yeah.
And a third of the angels. And we should have been able to learn from that. That's the original experiment that went bad. Mm-hmm. We were the confirmation.
So...
But, in Satan, we, Satan's
mind. So actually experience it isn't necessary.
What happened?
No.
You just brought that point up, so let me pursue that. What happened to Adam and Eve when they sinned?
They died.
No, not right then.
Well, they were dead meat.
They started separating from God.
Yeah, they began the process of separating from God. Okay, what else?
They knew something paradigms. Was wrong.
They had lost their special...
Their aura, or whatever it was.
They lost their God-given light. They had separated themselves from God through disobedience. They felt guilty, ashamed, and frightened. We know those things for sure. What do you think actually changed within them? You ever tried to ask yourself that?
That's a hard thing to define.
Well, he tried to make out like it was her problem. She gave it to me.
Yeah.
He didn't have to eat it.
Well, we're told that someday we will see the plan of salvation in 3D, living color, I added the 3D living color part, spread out across the skies in a kind of panorama. That's Great Controversy 666. I don't know how it ended up on page 666, but it's easy to remember it that way. We will be able to trace the terrible history of sin from its origin in heaven to its final end with the destruction of Satan. But it may be a long time before we fully understand all the details and implications. Of our sad experiment. Clearly, Adam's and Eve's relationships with God changed. Their relationship with each other changed. What are they doing? Whoa, that woman you gave me, huh? Okay. Their relationship to the environment and to other creatures on this earth also changed. They were specifically told that the serpent had become their enemy. You remember Genesis 3:15. We need to read that verse. I will make you and the woman hate each other. Are we supposed to hate? Maybe so in this case. Her offspring and yours will always be enemies.
We're not talking about Adam and Eve here.
No. God is addressing the snake, the serpent. And he's not really addressing the snake per se. He's addressing the one who's used the snake. Her offspring will crush your head and you will bite her offspring's heel. And what is that specifically talking about?
Well, a variety of things, but specifically, I'd say you're generally interpreted by Christians as just about the first prophetic announcement of the Messiah coming.
Mm-hmm. And his death on the cross.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We will no doubt spend eternity studying the plan of salvation. Certainly, thus, this must include many details about sin and its effects. Now, exactly how that's going to work out, I don't know. But this is what we do have. This would be Signs of the Times, December 30, 1889. It's in Our High Calling, page 45. Angelic perfection failed in heaven. Who are we talking about there?
It would be Satan.
And the people who followed him. Mm-hmm. Human perfection failed in Eden. That would be Adam and Eve, the paradise of bliss. All who wish for security in earth or heaven must look to the Lamb of God. What would that mean?
Look at the life of Jesus.
Yeah. The plan of salvation, making manifest the justice and love of God, provides an eternal safeguard. What does that mean? Against defection in unfallen worlds, as well as among those who shall be redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
The plan of salvation, or you could say the plan of healing.
Yeah.
It's a sick way of looking.
There's a lot right in those verses. Let's not miss it. What did it say? It provides a safeguard for who?
Unfallen worlds.
Unfallen worlds. As well as among those who redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
How is that?
Well, that's the question. Jim mentioned. Let me just read that, because someone might think I'm way out on a limb here. Look what it says in Colossians 1, verses 19 and 20.
And then the real question is, why in the world would they be in such jeopardy in the first place?
Well, Satan was the number one angel, the smartest, the biggest, the best, and he rebelled.
It doesn't sound like God created things very well when we say that.
That's the problem of love. With love, you have to have the freedom to make a choice. And the choice, like Gary says, is either to live in harmony or to go your own self-centered way. Self-centered way is separation from God, ends in death, sadly.
I quote Colossians 1, 19 and 20, for it was by God's own decision, now that's your question, why did God do this, that the Son has in himself the full nature of God. So that he wants to make sure you understand that in light of what he's going to say next. Through the Son, then, that would be his life and his death, God decided to bring the whole universe back to himself.
That's at one-ment.
Yeah. God made peace through his Son's blood on the cross, so that's how he did it, and so brought back to himself all things, both on earth and heaven. And I would, you know, I'm just going to summarize a little bit here about what I think that means. That's a really important point.
How about John 15, 14?
Yeah.
Before the blood of the cross. 15,
13.
What does the blood of the cross mean?
Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends.
Okay.
And Jesus, it's the ultimate demonstration. It's been stated before.
Right through the New Testament, we have the term the blood of Christ, used to refer to his sacrificial death. Now, what do we learn from, I would say, the life and the death, but particularly the death of Jesus? What do we learn from that death?
That he will love you until the end.
The results of separation from God.
Yeah. The death is a demonstration of what happens when you're separated from God.
I'm sorry, I was thinking about all of us spitting and throwing rocks at him as he's carrying the cross.
Yeah, exactly. Adam and Eve, I don't know if we should take time to read. Well, I think we have a moment. Look at Genesis 3, 10 to 19. How do they respond almost immediately? God comes down in the cool of the evening, and what happens?
Point finger.
He calls out to them, "Where are you?" Now, does he know where they are?
Of course.
Of course he knows where they are. Why is he calling out to them like this?
They're hiding.
Well, not hiding from him.
I bet they were.
They're ashamed.
They thought they were.
Well, they thought they were, yeah, but in their own limited mental understanding. Yeah.
So he answered, Adam answered, I heard you in the garden, I was afraid. We talked about being frightened and hid from you because I was naked. Who told you that you were naked, God asked. Did you eat the fruit that I told you not to eat? Of course, he knows the answer to these questions, doesn't he? The man answered, the woman you put here with me gave me the fruit, and I ate it. And the Lord asked the woman, why did you do this? She replied, the snake tricked me into eating it. In other words, God, why did you put the snake here? Then the Lord God said to the snake, you will be punished for this. You alone of all the animals must bear this curse. From now on, you'll crawl on your belly. You'll have to eat dust as long as you live. And, of course, we already read verse 15 and following. So what happens here? Immediately, they're blaming each other and they're blaming God.
I go to verse 22, 322. Don't leave that one out.
Okay. Well, we're going to get off on another subject here.
Well, at least.
Now the Lord God said, now the man has become like one of us and has knowledge of what is good and what is bad. He must not be allowed to take fruit from the tree that gives life, eat it, and live forever.
So when the serpent says, you'll be like God, knowing good and evil, or knowledge of what is good and bad, he was telling the truth.
Yeah. Yeah, we just don't need that knowledge of evil.
I thought separating oneself from God is what caused death.
It does.
So how has the tree of life got anything to do with this?
Well, that's a question which we're not going to answer today. Because we don't know the answer.
Oh,
but obviously, that has something to do with an obedient relationship to God. It has to.
I think it's a symbol of Jesus myself.
Yeah, well, fine. Adam and Eve needed to admit their responsibility for what they had done. God cursed the serpent. This is not just a matter of causing humans to despise snakes, but also a clear condemnation of the one who had used the snake for his own diabolical purposes. Eve was told that she would have pain in childbirth, and Adam was told that he would have to toil and sweat to raise the food that they would eat. Being expelled from the garden, they were faced with a choice: continue in the rebellion or seek to return to a right relationship with God. The other creatures were no longer in full subjection to Adam and Eve. So what evidence can you see in our world still suggesting that God is good and that he is very generous with us?
Still alive.
Yeah. Supposed Look around. Here's an interesting quotation from our Bible study guide. This is from the teacher section, I think. No, it's from the
Standard
section on Friday. Look around. We can see not only incredible beauty, but incredible design as well, all of which testifies to our Creator's love. For instance, think about such things as apples, oranges, tangerines, strawberries, blueberries, avocados, tomatoes, lemons, limes, watermelons, almonds, pecans, pears, plums, carrots, peas, bananas, pineapples, pomegranates, broccoli, kale, Brussels sprouts, onions, raspberries, cherries, celery, papaya, eggplant, rhubarb, spinach, melons, and on and on. Is it just by chance that all these are so tasty? Well, some people don't like Brussels sprouts. So good for us, and just happen to grow out of the ground bearing their own seed? Of course not. Who made them all like that? Obviously God did. So what can you see evidence around us, not only of God's goodness that we've just talked about, but of the results of sin in the world around us? What about animals killing other animals so they can eat them, just as a start? Well, it was God's plan for us to live forever in perfect peace and harmony in the beautiful setting of the Garden of Eden. But look what has happened to us. Well, how does the life and death of Jesus help to resolve the problems produced by that first sin? When God told us that the serpent is to be our enemy, was he just warning about poisonous snakes? Or was there a much larger danger he was trying to warn us about? Why is it that despite the fact that God declared Satan to be our enemy, so many people still think of God as our enemy? In the great controversy, the real question that human beings have to understand and answer for themselves is, who is telling us the truth? Is sin deadly? or was God lying to us, as Satan still insists? Satan claims that sin is perfectly safe. How many humans act as if that is true? Jesus came and lived his life here on earth. When his ministry was nearing its conclusion, he warned his disciples several times that he was going up to Jerusalem to be handed over to the Pharisees and Sadducees and end up being killed by the Romans. But was it really Romans who killed Jesus? Well, the real answer, of course, is no. Jesus died of sin, both in the Garden of Gethsemane, where we are told he fell dying to the ground, desire of ages 693, and an angel had to come and resuscitate him. And later, after being crucified on Calvary, he experienced the ultimate separation from God, which results in death, Isaiah 59, verse 2. The life and death of Jesus has given us the opportunity, you and me, every one of us, the opportunity to, as individuals, to answer the questions raised in the Garden of Eden. What were those questions again? Who is telling us the truth and who is lying? We can choose to live as much as possible the kind of life that Jesus lived and continue to live for eternity, or we can choose to continue in our rebellion as recommended by Satan, and we will die the kind of death which Jesus died, separated from God. Are those issues completely clear to you, and which will you choose? It would be my understanding that the life and death of Jesus give us a choice. We can choose to live as he lived, doing our best to watch him, to focus on the life of Jesus, to think about what he did and try to incorporate that into our lives every day, or we will die the death which he died. Not being crucified, not with nails in our hands or crowns of thorns on our head, but we will die the death that results from sin, the death that is an absolute result of sin, of separation from God. So when God said, "Don't eat of the tree," what was he really saying? You can't go it alone. You can't survive by yourself. Only in me can you live eternally. And that, friends, is what each one of us needs to choose. Our kind and loving Father, how could you have made it more clear? Of course, the stories are ancient, many of them. A lot of people choose to ignore the old stories. But for those who choose to look at it and dig around a little bit and try to understand what was happening there, it's a marvelous revelation, and we want to thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.